Due to the COVID-19 pandemic, there's been a lot of conversation regarding vaccines. This includes discussion on which vaccines people should take, whether it's safe to mix vaccines, and whether we will need booster shots. Among this discourse, there's a subset of individuals who are hesitant to get vaccinated. While vaccine hesitancy may seem to be a novel concept to some and associated with far-right political extremism, sentiments of governmental and scientific mistrust are as old as the institutions themselves. Historically, these apprehensions have led to polarization and the refusal of helpful resources due to the source that is providing them. Past vaccine hesitancy occurred through this same stream of thinking. People are typically more concerned with the producers and distributors of the vaccines rather than the contents of the medication, as the general population tends to not know this information. The first major example came very soon after the popularization of smallpox vaccines in the late 1700s, when the process of administering the vaccine variolation was used on the King of Britain's son. Despite the 1-2% fatality rate of the procedure, minuscule compared to the 30% fatality rate of smallpox, King George III's son passed away from a complication, causing mass fear and promoting the notion that vaccines are unnatural. Another famous example came in the late 1900s, where smear campaigns in the media were used to push anti-vaccine ideologies. In 1982, a documentary titled DPT Vaccine Roulette was released, linking a child's history of suffering seizures and brain damage to being given the diphtheria pertussis tetanus vaccine. This led to the formation of the organization Dissatisfied Parents Together, which is one of the most influential anti-vaccine organizations in the USA. To understand vaccine hesitancy, it's important to investigate where it stems from, especially in our modern-day societies. According to surveys conducted by the Public Health Agency of Canada, 70% of Canadian parents surveyed were concerned about potential side effects of vaccines, and 38% believed that a vaccine could potentially cause the disease that it was supposed to prevent. One source that has generated a lot of vaccine hesitancy, especially in recent years, has been the study published by Andrew Wakefield in The Lancet linking receiving the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine and autism. Wakefield falsified data, misquoted patients, and secretly invested in a competing vaccine company. His deceit was not caught for 12 years, while the misinformation about vaccines and autism became widespread. When parents were surveyed regarding why they were having difficulty making the decision to vaccinate their children, 8% raised concerns about the potential links to autism. This demonstrates the lasting effects of this study even now, years after the study has been disproved and retracted from the Lancet Journal. A huge factor that contributes to vaccine hesitancy is the source of information that parents refer to. It was found that 63% of parents look for information about vaccination on the internet. This is very concerning since information about vaccines online, especially on social media, is often inaccurate or negative. Also, a large number of anti-vaccine websites exist that propagate a range of anti-vaccine messages. Likewise, getting information from family or friends can also be inaccurate and misleading. Researchers found that parents who received information about vaccines from physicians were less likely to have vaccination concerns than those who received information from family members or friends. This demonstrates the need for accurate and reliable sources to prevent misinformation and mistrust surrounding vaccines. Another reason for vaccine hesitancy is fostered by how medical professionals have failed minority communities and have also exploited them in the past. Although the pandemic has impacted everyone, the burden of COVID-19 disproportionately falls on members of ethnic minority groups. Black, Indigenous, and other people of color are nearly threefold more likely to be hospitalized due to COVID-19 and approximately twofold more likely to die from the disease compared with white non-Hispanic individuals. Using the frame of vaccine hesitancy mistakenly places the responsibility on minoritized groups to become less hesitant rather than on public health systems to become more trustworthy and accessible. For example, a UK study that included data from a 2,600 people survey and qualitative interviews showed that twice as many Asian and Black respondents have faced discrimination when accessing local services such as the police than the white population. The study also indicated that past experiences of such discrimination, example, respondents stating that services actively make my life more difficult, are associated with lower vaccine uptake. There are also concerns related to historical practices of minoritized groups being unethically exploited in medical experiments. Black, Indigenous, and other people of color might question whether pharmaceutical companies and public health services are fully informing and protecting them, knowing that this was not the case in past programs, such as the U.S. Tuskegee Syphilis Study. This is an infamous study that occurred from 1932 to 1972. It initially involved 600 black men, 399 with syphilis, and 201 who did not have the disease. Participants' informed consent was not collected. What the men in the study didn't know was that penicillin, which is the treatment of choice for syphilis, was available by 1943, but participants in the study were not treated. The study only ended in 1972 because an advisory panel declared it to be ethically unjustified, as there was no reason to withhold treatment just to study the effects of syphilis. Ultimately, investments in health information will be most effective when the groups that information is tailored for trust health services more than they trust other non-medical sources of advice. While it is reasonable for people to be hesitant due to many of the reasons listed earlier, it's important to know that vaccine use and implementation have health effects not only for themselves, but also for the health of the greater community. Vaccinations work by introducing the body to a small amount of the live pathogen, with an example of pathogens being smallpox or COVID-19. This would allow the body to learn to defend itself without having a person get really sick and only experiencing small side effects generally. Through this process, the immune system learns how to properly respond to being introduced to the live pathogen again and provides preventable measures to ensure the body is safe and protected from sickness. This process provides safety individually and is a safe process both proven through decades of research and success in eradicating diseases of the past. Saying this, viruses and pathogens can mutate and learn to adapt, leading to new outbreaks and rendering the body's immunity useless, and it does not know how to defend itself from the mutation. This is why herd immunity is important. Herd immunity occurs when a substantial amount of the population becomes vaccinated against a certain disease, thus giving the pathogen no ability to mutate. Without the possibility of mutation, the disease slowly begins to find less and less suitable hosts to survive in, and eventually becomes obsolete in the population. Herd immunity is key for protecting at-risk populations, both from a geographical and physiological perspective. This process has been shown to be effective and is a key reason why diseases such as tuberculosis and smallpox have become so rare, as most of the population has been vaccinated against them, and thus are able to kill the live pathogen before infection and disease can follow. Through vaccinations, community protection is established, thus protecting the whole and not just the individual. Through group vaccination, like we are currently seeing in the COVID-19 pandemic, active cases, morbidity, and mortality begin to shrink in, thus ending the viral threat for the greater good. When discussing vaccination stance and status, it's important to create a form of open dialogue in which a person feels heard and understood. By listening to concerns and hesitancy and understanding the situation from their perspective, you can best explain the benefits in easy-to-understand terms and get your message across most successfully. By attempting to educate them in a calm and collective manner, individuals will better be able to understand your point of view. Addressing their concerns and providing them with evidence and statistics that helps to debunk false information will help you best be able to discuss vaccinations and help them consider other perspectives regarding this topic.